It would be interesting, maybe there have been experiments along these lines with children of various ages.
Bill Gates' depopulation technology was made in a genetic engineering lab founded by Jeffrey Epstein. This technology is invisible, silent, and yet it is more deadly than nuclear bombs. This video will show you a side of the Epstein saga which you have never heard before. This is the reason that Bill Gates was meeting Epstein after his 2008 conviction for minors, and it explains why the Gates Foundation science advisor, Boris Nikolic, pictured here at Epstein's New York mansion, was named executor in Epstein's last will and testament that was written only 2 days before he didn't kill himself. A will whose signing was witnessed by El Chapo Guzman's lawyer and CEO. The girls were just the cover-up, a distraction from a much bigger story. In telling this story again, I mean to make it as easy to digest as possible to understand for new viewers and old subscribers. Additionally, this new round of research has uncovered a lot more shocking. It's kind of the YouTube catchphrase, but shocking information. But to make it easier to understand, I'm going to try to make it as concise as possible. So be aware that the original videos will have greatly expanded source material, particularly long video clips, where I just let these guys talk and explain themselves. So if you're here, I'm just going to assume that you're aware of Bill Gates' interest in depopulation. I'm not going to add a bunch of clips and weigh this video down by going over all of that. Chances are you've seen it 1,000 times. Well, in recent years, Bill Gates has funded the dropping of billions of genetically engineered mosquitoes around the world through a company called Oxitec. And around 1 billion of these genetically engineered mosquitoes were dropped in Florida, I think in 2020, 2021 maybe. I made a video on it anyway. And it was in an alleged effort to prevent a disease that actually had zero endemic cases. That was in the video Eugenics Are Here, and it's worth the watch just to find out how hilariously flawed their safety mechanisms were, or are. So these mosquitoes were only genetically modified with fluorescent markers to glow in the dark under certain type of light. And they are a run-up to what is called a gene drive. Gene drives are the ultimate depopulation device. They break normal 50% Mendelian inheritance, and they spread at a 100% rate. And without every carrier of this gene drive gene going extinct, it will eventually spread through the entire population, generally causing infertility or extinction. But without getting into the weeds, not necessarily. And these things spread exponentially over generations. So you only need a very small introductory group of genetically modified specimens to, within a few generations, infect most of the species, if not all. This ability to drive a gene to cause depopulation has been proposed by many governments around the world as a method to eliminate undesirable invasive species. The government of New Zealand specifically has a program called the Predator Free 2030 or the Predator Free 2040 program, something like that. And that's a plan to use gene drives to exterminate 8 species of mammals, including rats and possums. And this is despite the fact that their creator, the creator of the gene drive, Kevin Esvelt, said that it is near impossible to contain a gene drive and that once one is released, they would likely spread through the entire world.
Problem, of course, is it has everything it needs to copy itself. And this is, in principle, easy enough to do that a lot of people have the ability to engineer, say, a fruit fly to do this. And if they were to do that and let that fly escape outside, there's a non-trivial chance that it's going to find a mate, and most of the offspring are inherit. And if enough of them survive to mate, and their offspring inherit, then the odds that it will, by chance, go extinct become low enough that it will eventually spread through the local population around wherever this was released, and then further by assisted by human transport all around the world, potentially to every population of that species, whatever that species is.
So you're putting the entire world's rat population at risk because you don't want them in New Zealand. They came there invasively, and you're going to figure that they can't get back out. Just take your luck on that, right? Nevertheless, Bill Gates is on the cusp of infecting the world's mosquito population with gene drives. In 2016, he declared that the technology would be ready to deploy in 2 years, expressing frustration at safety concerns that slowed the progress of his project.
But that really wasn't enough, right? Because people are going to want to use this. And as long as people want to use this, eventually someone will. That is to say, if it is possible for a small group of scientists to build something that could take a decent crack out of malaria, someone's going to want to be a hero and release it without consulting everyone else.
Gates and his foundation consistently influence national policies and are key players in formulating global policy. Meanwhile, governments and even the FBI are utterly unprepared for this technology to the extent that they're even aware of it.
At present, there are no guidelines that speak specifically to gene drives, and we'll discuss that in a few minutes. But relevant U.S. guidelines and technical documents are not yet sufficient on their own to guide ecological risk assessment for gene drive technology. This is a gap that we did identify. But we concluded that existing mechanisms of governance may be inadequate to address potential immediate and long-term environmental and public health consequences because they don't consider gene drives' intentional spread. They don't consider gene drives' potential irreversible effect on ecosystems. Often they lack clarity in the jurisdiction of their oversight and who it is that is responsible for which components of oversight. Most of them provide no structure for public engagement, and those that do have insufficient structures for public engagement, and they don't address the potential for misuse.
As this story unfolds, you'll see that the Epstein Gates funded lab at MIT is the center point of a spider web interconnected in every direction. For some reason, which may be relevant later, I'm censored every time I even try to type the name of Epstein's lab into the YouTube comment section. I wonder what problem Susan Wojcicki could have with me talking about Jeffrey Epstein's Program for Evolutionary Dynamics. Doesn't seem like a bad word to me, but gets caught by the algorithms every time. In July 2021, Rolling Stone magazine ran an article titled, "Was Jeffrey Epstein a Spy?" What is particularly interesting is what didn't make this article. The head of Epstein's lab, sometimes using the title transferably with Epstein himself, is a longtime Gates associate by the name of Nicholas Negroponte. During the MIT inquiries regarding the covered-up Epstein payments, Negroponte defended the importance of Epstein's research, and he made a female colleague cry. But what is truly notable about Nicholas Negroponte isn't the man himself, but his brother, John.
Yeah, I backed Hillary Clinton during the campaign. Right. I am a Republican.
The former U.S. ambassador to Honduras, accused of facilitating a CIA coup, was the first director of national security. The DNS office was created under George W. Bush, post-9/11 Homeland Security measures, and oversees all of the nation's 17 intelligence agencies. So if you were a journalist asking the question, was Jeffrey Epstein a spy, you might think that working with the brother of the DNS would make the article. They never responded to the correction email I sent them. When the director of the MIT Media Lab, Joy Ito, resigned for his part in covering up the donations and also receiving $500,000 from Epstein for his private startups, an interesting voice rose to Ito's defense.
Hi, Bob.
Thank Hi, you. Joey. How are you doing?
Good time. And I'm always so appreciative of your time and generosity.
It's always a pleasure.
Thank you.
The co-founder of vaccine company Moderna, Robert Langer, who praised the research being done at the lab. Also of MIT, Langer designed the lipid nanoparticles that Moderna and Pfizer both use.
you know, we helped start Moderna, and Moderna's in clinical trials with the nanoparticle mRNA vaccine, nanotechnology. You know, nanotechnology has been key, actually, to delivering mRNA.
There are new, what I'll call genetic drugs, drugs like siRNA that can turn genes off, or DNA or mRNA that could, say, turn genes on.
He and Gates have developed time-released mRNA vaccines that self-boost. He is designing wireless birth control implants for Bill Gates. And at Bill Gates' personal request, he has created vaccine-tracking semiconducting crystals, also called microchips, that use transgenic luciferase to read and write vaccination records. They also definitely do not exist, according to the BBC fact check, who asked Moderna's media rep, Journalism in Current Year.
To be clear, do you want a vaccine so that you can implant microchips into people?
No, there's no connection between any of these vaccines and any tracking type thing at all. I don't know where that came from.
And yet there was a poll by YouGov and Yahoo that shows 44% of Republicans, 19% of Democrats, and 24% of independents think that you want to do that. How did this conspiracy start?
I don't know.
In addition to creating the technology behind Pfizer's and Moderna's vaccines and making him a multi-billionaire in the process, Langer also helped create a company called SiO2. The name, sharing its chemical formula for silica or quartz, makes the vials and syringes for the mRNA vaccines. Nice racket, eh?
That's like you've listed sort of like every aspect of this virus you have your hands in.
Also, you know, this is a very underserved thing, but vials, you know, when you develop these vaccines, you need to actually package them.
Okay. So the list that you've just given me is like every aspect of this virus you in some way are involved in, and yet it's only been a few months.
And the vaccine works. Bill Gates, as you may know, he actually predicted that all these things might happen. He has a TED talk from 2015. And I remember when he came to see me in 2012, he kept bringing up, you know, vaccines. And
Langer's defense of Epstein's research was primarily in regard for his friend and associate, Joy Ito. There doesn't seem to be any direct connections between himself and Epstein on the public record. It is interesting to note, however, just how many mutual associates they had and how many colleagues of the Moderna founder were in private meetings or on private islands with Epstein. More importantly, however, is their shared connection to Bill Gates and the projects that Bill Gates personally sponsored and that they have so blatantly lied about. So while nobody else seems to have any idea where this whole vaccine tracking implant thing came from, I think I might have found a clue. And that is the Particles for Humanity presentation to the J.P. Morgan conference. You might remember J.P. Morgan is the Epstein-affiliated bank. And this was given January 2019, so it's pretty remarkable that everybody forgot about it by mid-2020. And Particles for Humanity has initial funding from, of course, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And their plans are for self-boosting vaccines, vaccine-tracking implants, and food fortification or nutrient encapsulation in injections, a vaccine tracking system featuring on-patient medical record embedding vaccination information into the skin, invisible data, only readable by custom mobile technology. And who is behind this? Well, the Moderna founder, Robert Langer, and oh, our old friend Boris Nikolic. So Bill Gates doesn't know what he's funding or what his old science advisor is up to, I guess. Even though he's personally visited Langer and asked him to make these devices for him. While there's no evidence linking Moderna founder Robert Langer directly to Jeffrey Epstein, the same can't be said for former White House science advisor Eric Lander. I made a dedicated video about this called Science is Back, but long story short, the Biden White House proclaimed Science is back as they appointed Eric Lander as the first science advisor to be given a White House cabinet position. Here he is sitting in Epstein's office in a laboratory that made Bill Gates' depopulation technology. Brought into the White House to help roll out the mRNA vaccines, Lander actually had his own COVID vaccine company called Kodiak Biosciences. Moderna's parent company, Flagship Pioneering, were major investors in Lander's company, but further than that, Lander was an investor in BioNTech, who co-produced the Pfizer vaccine. There was talk of him divesting those assets, which would have been near peak price anyway, or being given a waiver by the ethics committee. Conflict of interest resolved, I'm sure. I don't know what ever happened to that. Prior to his appointment as the first science advisor to hold a cabinet position, 500 female scientists had signed a petition to stop Lander due to his apparently infamous sexism. Langer had also written an article in favor of Human Genome Project founder George Church, remember that name, being given the 2020 Nobel Prize for Chemistry for the discovery of CRISPR-Cas9, in place of the actual winner, Jennifer Doudna, whose research he downplayed as more derivative. This is not surprising, considering that nearly two decades prior, Church and Lander worked together on the $3 billion Human Genome Project. Known as the founding father of genetics, George Church was the fifth person to have his genome fully sequenced, and the first to make it publicly available. But not for long, he intends to launch it as the first genomic NFT. In light of these accusations by 500 women, there was an ethics committee regarding Lander's reputation, his conflicts of interest, and you can watch it on C-SPAN. Some of the C-SPAN footage made it to the full video. Lander apologized, said it wouldn't happen again.
Jeffrey Epstein was an abhorrent individual, and my heart goes out to his victims. I chose to have no association whatsoever with him. We never requested funds. We never received funds from him, from his foundation.
He was not long after fired from the White House for abusing and bullying staff and alleged sexism. Eric Lander will make one more appearance in this video, but I'm saving that for later. In the intro, I stated that the Gates Foundation science advisor, a man named Boris Nikolic, was named an executor of Epstein's last will and testament only 2 days before his death. If this wasn't suspicious enough, Nikolic founded Bingo, an investor syndicate created exclusively to invest in the companies of Editas and Veritas, the company of superstar genetic engineer George Church, pictured here in Jeffrey Epstein's office. When you're doing this sort of researching, you're always finding something new while you're covering old material. Part of this investment team was Flagship Ventures, the investment wing of Flagship Pioneering, the owner of Moderna. I had also discovered a similar link between George Church and Flagship Pioneering in a previous video.
George Church is a science advisor for Tessera, a sister company of the same owner, Flagship Pioneering.
But all of that is nothing compared to what I just stumbled on. From investment news, you know, the guys who are actually motivated to dig because it could get them a little money. A lot of money. So in this story, Jeffrey Epstein transferred $578 million to a trust just days before his suicide. All of his assets were transferred to the trust on August 8th, 2 days before he died. That's the exact same day that he wrote a new will naming the Gates Foundation science advisor, who was actually just third in line for the will. As Investor News points out, however, this transfer to a private trust means that nobody can actually tell where the money went, and his victims, who are suing his estate, or who probably will be suing the estate when this was written, wouldn't necessarily be able to get to the money because nobody knows where it's gone. So you remember, Editas is George Church's genetic engineering company. Boris Nikolic had a $42 million stake. You'll remember Bill Gates also has a significant stake in the company. Mr. Nikolic waxed enthusiastic about Mr. Epstein's financial advice in discussions with private bankers leading up to the Editas offering. I've never had this direct tie before between Nicklick directly to George Church facilitating this multi-million dollar deal for his genetic engineering company. This is huge. This ties everything together. Mr. Epstein's enthusiasm for scientific endeavors and high-profile researchers has been well documented. He was hosted at Harvard as recently as 2014 by George Church, a biologist who oversees the Harvard Human Genome Project. According to online calendars, Epstein provided funding to the project. Mr. Church founded Eugenics to develop synthetic organs as well as Editas. Both firms received early investment from Biomatic Capital, where Mr. Nicklick is one of the two managing directors. Biomatics, which is based in Boston and Seattle, is run by several former staffers from the Gates Foundation and Gates Ventures. Mr. Church didn't respond to requests for comment. Flagship's owner, Nubar Afayan, he also made the WikiLeaks asking John Podesta for influence in East Asia. And previously, Podesta had operated an oil-from-air company called Jewel Unlimited, and it collapsed behind him, made him a fortune just as he left to join the Obama campaign. It's easy to start tugging at threads and get distracted. So if you take away one name from this story, it should be George Church. Formerly an advocate of unregulated human genetic engineering, he's since changed his mind. From proposing humans 2.0 at SpaceX in a now-deleted video.
Reading DNA, because reading and writing DNA are very heavily interconnected. In the second point where we're talking about humans 2.0, I'll mention it.
To resurrecting the woolly mammoth and even undoing the damages of aging, Church is the modern Prometheus. He is literally referred to as the father of genetics. Remember his name.
It's who you know. That's how you live forever. Right. It's who you know.
Yeah.
But Church was not alone. Other notable names at the lab were Martin Nowak, another man often named as head of the lab.
Maybe you could introduce yourself.
My name is Martin Nowak, and I'm a professor of mathematics and of biology at Harvard University.
I think Martin wanted to talk about the kind of relationship between design and evolution.
Nowak wasn't only a recipient of Epstein money, but also Gates money, and sometimes they funded the same project. Here is Martin Nowak lecturing to Epstein and associates on what appears to be a tropical island.
I'm kind of like cooperating to keep a loaded gun on your belt. That'd be me.
You are cooperating.
Cooperate to keep a loaded gun on your belt. In other words, you know, cooperate but watch your back. I find, you know, if you get away from simple A versus B, you get to a situation where it's fine to cooperate, but it pays to be cynical. Your trust to verify,
yes,
but, you know, something like that. I find in the real world, for me, maybe outside of kinship relationships, or maybe even with, you have to really kind of watch the nuance. You're not going to defect immediately, but you want to keep your running shoes on.
Yes, I often ask myself, how do people really play these games of cooperation and defection?
Here we see Martin Nowak, George Church, and Epstein deep in conversation, somewhere warm and sandy. And as long as this video is, there are people in this video who show up elsewhere we won't even have time to cover. Indeed, one of the most evidenced accusations against Epstein comes from Prince Andrew victim Virginia Guffrey, who directly named the now-deceased Marvin Minsky, also of the MIT Media Lab. And this man who looks the part is Seth Lloyd. I'll let him speak for himself.
Interrupting for a long time, and I saw him on many occasions. I never saw him with underage women. However, and I actually never saw him do anything creepy. But the one creepy thing about him is he traveled around with two assistants who were women in their 20s, who are typically very beautiful, and they were presumably former Victoria's Secret models. And they were the people who, like, you know, brought him his peanut butter sandwiches. And those are the people I saw. Now, they were not underage. I talked with them. They were intelligent young women in their 20s. And they were, but it was creepy that he traveled around with them. However, I never saw him with a bunch of underage with any underage at all. It's not up to me about whether he was nice or not. I think that, you know, the stuff at the Media Lab of them saying, the administration was accepting donations. They said, oh, we're not accepting donations from Jeffrey Epstein, but then they are accepting them under the table. That's pretty bad.
In my previous videos, I significantly underestimated the length of Epstein's involvement to the lab, which he visited up until 2018. He was still donating money to it until 2015. And while previously, George Church, he apologized for taking $500,000 from Epstein between 2005 and 2007. He then took another $2 million between 2010 and 15. Millions and millions more went to Church's colleagues from Epstein. So this puts Epstein's relationship with the lab that he originally founded well past the point where its members helped create CRISPR genetic engineering, but even past the point that the gene drive was created. Incidentally, Gates deemed the gene drive ready for deployment right around the time that Epstein didn't kill himself. In MIT's internal investigation, the president of the university himself, Raphael Reif, was implicated in covering up the Bill Gates funding of Jeffrey Epstein's program. These were not done through usual donation channels like the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, but personal and secret financing. The director of the media lab, Joy Ito, was also implicated and resigned. A couple other people too that, again, I just don't have time to dig into everything. It was Joy Ito who, along with Microsoft board member Reid Hoffman, introduced Jeffrey Epstein to Peter Thiel and Elon Musk. The implications of this meeting are taken far away from reality on social media by the assumption that everything Epstein touched was a teenage girl. Although, I do wonder where it was that Thiel gained his interest in parabiosis, or the use of young blood to revitalize the elderly. A concern you'll understand more later. It was Reid Hoffman, Microsoft chairman and the founder of LinkedIn, who gave Jeffrey Epstein an MIT Disobedience Award. My video on the Disobedience Award uncovered an interesting piece of hashtag MeToo fraud, but I'll let you watch that if you want. Hoffman started a fact-checking company with George Soros called Good Information. That was fairly recent. Made a video on that too. You will see Reid Hoffman everywhere once you know who he is. He's also the founder of LinkedIn, which explains the sudden and undue influence they have over the employment of middle managers.
I was planning on being the director of the CIA.
Yes, you heard that right. Reid wanted, briefly, to be the director of the CIA. But hear him out.
I said, well, if we all kind of formed a pact and each of us would go for a different leadership position, you know, someone's going to be president, someone's going to be, this is back then, CEO of IBM. And if we all went to these different positions, then we could collaborate and we could then make the world a better place. By having high trust and being in all these different leadership positions, we could impose a different structure.
Among the major Epstein revelations was the Edge Club billionaire dinner galas that Epstein attended with other luminaries from around the world. Although largely scrubbed from their site, I spent hours digging up photos and videos, and what's interesting is how small the clubs actually are. Here is George Church mentioned previously, the one name you should remember, and the fifth human to have their genome sequenced. Here is Craig Venter, the first human to have their genome sequenced, the first person to create synthetic life.
We did this first with a small virus that infects E. coli. And the virus was about 5,000 base pairs long. We made it chemically. We injected it into E. coli. And this was the first experiment of what happened. E. coli read a synthetic piece of DNA, like normal DNA, started making proteins. The proteins self-assembled and made the virus, and the virus killed the cells. So we call this a situation where the software builds its own hardware. We wrote a piece of chemical code, put it in a bacteria, and it made a virus.
Venter ran a private business competitor to the Human Genome Project, and they published their results the same month as Eric Lander published the results of the $3 billion Human Genome Project. Do you remember a few years back when double helix DNA discoverer James Watson was canceled? Well, it's a bit ironic considering the nature of cancellation that he once described Venter as Adolf Hitler and urged his colleagues to act like Churchill in opposing him rather than act like Chamberlain. This regarded when Venter was an NIH employee who studied mRNA expression in the human brain. The NIH Office of Technology Transfer intended to patent all the genomes it mapped in Venter's name, which would amount to about 1,000 genetic sequences a month. Watson's conjecture was that genes shouldn't be formally patented without understanding their function first, and while I believe that Watson was right in that is how patent law works, but apparently the patent plan was dropped. This little anecdote does interlock with the rest of the puzzle perfectly somehow. And here they are at the Edge Club with 23andMe owner Anne Wojcicki, who is the sister of YouTube's CEO, Susan, and Anne's ex-husband, Google founder Sergey Brin, and their friend Larry Page. You know, also a Google founder, in case you didn't know that. So could this explain why just simply dropping the name of Epstein's lab in the YouTube comments section activates the censors? Even posts about CRISPR and genetic engineering that won the 2020 Nobel Prize for Chemistry, those can trigger the constantly changing algorithm. But as the Twitter files show, it's hardly necessary for the executives to all be working together for a conspiracy of silence to pervade when the government itself is getting involved, when intelligence agencies are giving the orders. So is there not enough to tie all these figures together yet? Well, check out this article. Two Massachusetts Institute of Technology researchers were among the first recipients of the new Breakthrough Prize in Life Sciences Wednesday, a new philanthropic venture which rewards scientists with a $3 million prize for contributing research focused on curing intractable disease and elongating human life. Dr. Eric Lander and Dr. Robert Weinberg were both recognized and given the prize. Lander is a leader in human genomic research and a founding director of the Broad Institute of MIT and Harvard. Robert Langer,
nanotechnology,
a professor at the Koch Institute at MIT, said both professors are ideal recipients for this award. They are both fantastic, he said. We would not know what we would do today without Lander's enormous contributions. Langer said, both scientists are also upstanding people. Not only are these two individuals among the world's top scientists, they are also very nice people and great human beings, he said. I feel privileged to know them. Sure ate those words, didn't he? The Breakthrough Prize was founded this year by four of Silicon Valley's elite figures. The founders include Google's co-founder Sergey Brin, his wife and founder of the genetics company, 23andMe, Anne Wojcicki.
So Eric was actually one of the first people we consulted with. Like in those early days, I think I crashed one of your conferences and I was like, hi. Yeah, I don't think we were invited. But we just showed up and we were like, yeah, you know, we're thinking of launching this and introducing it to people. And it was definitely a controversial idea at that time about what is the right way to do it.
Facebook founder and CEO Mark Zuckerberg and Russian entrepreneur and philanthropist Yuri Brin. I'm guessing he is related to Sergey. So, you know, it's all those people that I just mentioned. How funny that that keeps happening. Wojcicki said in a press release Wednesday that she was excited to be able to honor these scientists on such a large scale. We are thrilled to support scientists who think big, take risks, and have made significant impact on our lives, she said. These scientists should be household names and heroes in society. What do they call it when you like hold a contest and it's got a monetary prize and then you just give it to your friend? Is that like fraud or seems like something? Money laundering? I don't know.
You know, it's a remarkable example of something I think that only goes on in the U.S. We have this thing I sometimes call the miracle machine.
Yeah.
You got the federal government, you got philanthropy, and you have industry.
Right.
And that creates this amazing virtuous cycle where we create public goods mm-hmm. with the federal government
yeah.
and with mm-hmm. with philanthropy mm-hmm. that gets shared all over the place, and then industry runs with that, and right. then it feeds back. And
yeah.
I don't think a lot of other countries have all of those pieces working together like this.
But one thing is clear to me, that these are not people who are all being silenced by sex trafficking blackmail. Ann Wojcicki even brought her mom and dad to a TED talk related to the Edge meetings. At best, sex is an intoxicant which helps facilitate further corruption. These are aging elites that are grasping at the edges of immortality, the power over life and death. They could carve out destiny and create a new world of their design. They talk about it constantly.
I have a second story induced by Steve's brilliant talk and by people who don't do violence, but they imagine violence. And it's a story of a Viennese professor walking in front of his department, and there's a flag of mourning over the department. And somebody says to him, "Oh my God, that's so bad. One of your colleagues has died. Who is it?" And the professor said, "I don't know. I'm equally happy about anybody."
Editing yourself. Editing unborn children, selecting for traits like intelligence and muscle growth are all real. They're being done already. They've already been done.
Like, I could order this stuff to my house. I could order a microinjector on eBay. Companies do single-cell sequencing for me, right? The only thing I need is somebody to retrieve embryos, get sperm, and do the implantation. The question isn't anymore how are they going to regulate us. It's how are they going to stop us. We've been doing gene therapy on humans since the late 90s. We know it works. We know you can modify humans. This isn't something that, like, people should question anymore. It works. That's what I want to tell people. That's what I want to let people know. That's what I want people to do. Modify yourself.
You've almost certainly seen genetically modified athletes, prime candidates being the Chinese weightlifters at the last Summer Olympics. Stem cells can be used to replicate fertilized eggs, beginning fetuses, zygotes, whatever you call them, to create thousands of identical clones.
Through stem cells or induced stem cells, we'll be able to generate larger numbers of eggs, because right now human eggs are a limiting factor. And then if you have 1,000 eggs that are blastocysts that are fertilized eggs, and you're doing this probabilistic analysis of each of them, it really opens up a lot of issues and a lot of possibilities.
So there are genetically modified humans. CRISPR is just one of many technologies that's particularly promising, because you can rapidly prototype and precisely change, not just add in an extra copy, which is what typically gene therapy has been, but you can alter specific places. Now, back to Bob's point that we can screen for embryos. Well, that assumes that if you start screening for a large number of things, if you screen for one thing, then about half your embryos are okay. If you screen for two things, it's going to be one quarter, and so forth. You get up to 10 things, and you don't have enough embryos. So the alternative would be to genetically engineer them to be whatever you want them to be.
We're fully into a brave new world now. There's a reason that Epstein's geneticists are all hanging out at the billionaire's dinner with the owner of the world's biggest DNA repository. It's the same reason Bill Gates and Francis Collins give.
You know, thank God the digital world is sort of giving us infinite storage and computation, because geneticists are one of the few people who can fill up those disks.
And we're doing it.
So thank you for all of your data that will allow these cloud computing facilities to grow with no end in sight.
They have a great future.
In fact, it's quite likely that all of your medical records, whether you're in a medical study or not, is already in somebody else's hands that you don't want, because your medical records are worth 20 times on the black market your credit card.
So thank you for all of your data.
From generating genetic shadow profiles for family members like Facebook does for social media, to behavioral prediction, the vast amount of data that 23andMe generates is hidden from the consumer who purchases the service. Your DNA screening is in fact subsidized by the information they extract for it. information that George Church has said is worth 6 to 10 times your credit card limit.
20 times.
That probably explains why, besides geneticists, the second biggest group of academics there seem to be computational scientists or mathematicians. Like our anecdote with the NIH inventor's patents earlier, it's not enough to decode the genome, you need to understand it.
I've been accused of having balls of steel. Now I know I have 6 repeats in my androgen receptor. So we can explain everything in life eventually through the genome. My genome was the first one sequenced, and the disappointing thing 15 years ago was, despite all the studies in genetics, I could tell very little from looking at my genome. And so it's been clear to me for a long time the way geneticists did genetics was over. But the thing that had to replace it was large numbers. We have to use massive computing and machine learning to make associations that mere mortals can't easily make. So the health nucleus started out as a massive phenotyping effort. We wanted to measure everything we could about humans, physically and, where possible, mentally. The diameter of your spinal cord, or the size of your hippocampus. We wanted to have actual measurements comprehensively across the human body that we could relate back to the genetic code to find the associations between those.
It's a small club, and all of the people in our story are somehow in it. The Edge Club and this group of MIT scientists are theoretically totally separate, but in reality, they're deeply intertwined through their shared connection to Gates and Epstein's research.
Because I love Nicholas. I have dinner with him a couple times a month.
To quickly summarize it, people who attend every event are Anne Wojcicki, Sergey Brin, and Larry Page, who are all deeply interconnected. Another frequent attendee, or seemingly constant attendee, Microsoft's research director, former research director Nathan Myhrvold, mentioned elsewhere in this story, Jeff Bezos, Craig Venter. These are the guys who always seem to be at the meetings. Of the rest of the attendees, roughly half are a small group of employees from Google, Facebook, and Microsoft, and the other half are split between geneticists and computational engineers with a handful of journalists sprinkled in. These gala dinners are put on by the host, John Brockman, the shadowy figure at the top of the cyber fashion food chain, to quote his website. Brockman and his wife are both literary publishers that specialize in the STEM field. Interestingly, Ghislaine Maxwell's dad, Robert, who also didn't kill himself, was a publisher of science literature as well. In an interesting crossover, Wired magazine was founded by the head of Epstein's research lab, Nicholas Negroponte. In an interesting crossover, Wired magazine was founded by the head of Epstein's genetic engineering lab, Nicholas Negroponte, seen here at the Edge Club dinners, seen here speaking at the World Economic Forum. So Negroponte founded Wired magazine, yet according to Andrew Brown writing for The Guardian, quote, "It is almost an obligation on the editor of Wired to be a Brockman client." John Brockman he's talking about. So if you want to work at Negroponte's paper, you need to know John Brockman. It is worth reiterating here that Nicholas Negroponte's brother John was the top U.S. intelligence official during the height of the post-9/11 Homeland Security measures. If there is a continued operation involving underage girls, I would investigate John Brockman's inner circle. There are more red flags around him than there are Xi Jinping.
Another guest was John Brockman, the literary agent. Now, he described really? Seeing you there getting a foot massage from a young Russian woman. Did that happen?
No.
You're absolutely sure, or yeah, you can't remember?
Absolutely sure.
So John Brockman's statement is false?
Well, I wouldn't, I don't know Mr. Brockman, so I don't know what he's talking about.
But that definitely wasn't you getting a foot massage from a Russian girl in Jeffrey Epstein's house?
No.
Here is his son, Max Brockman, appearing very close with Sarah Kellen. Kellen was declared to be, in a court of law, declared to be criminally responsible in luring young girls for Epstein to abuse. Here she was photographed walking with Epstein, even after his conviction, outside of his New York mansion. This isn't the last we'll see of Sarah Kellen. Following this logic of association, I noticed Max Brockman was especially friendly with this John Pigozzi guy, who is a frequent attendee, so I decided to Google him. Here is an image of John Pigozzi attending a party at Ghislaine Maxwell's house in 2007. Alleged Epstein fixer and Ghislaine Maxwell deputy, Sarah Kellen was also there. Isn't it strange how this tiny circle all seemed to know each other through multiple connections? The article itself is an apologia sob story for the woman beside Pigozzi, Peggy Seagal, also seen here with Harvey Weinstein. Well, what was her crime? What's she been accused of? Well, she smuggled Epstein into parties that she organized for elites. I guess she gets paid to put on parties, something like that. In 2011, she organized a party for Prince Andrew at Epstein's New York mansion.
Well, I was there, so there was a dinner. I don't think it was quite as you might put it, but yeah, okay, I was there for I was there at a dinner, yeah.
So with this in mind, I re-examined the Edge Club photos and found Pigozzi here with Olga of Greece. It seems strange that this young lady has a pseudonym instead of a name. I wonder if it's on any flight logs. But if that was the only questionable girl at these Edge Club meetings, it wouldn't mean very much. But there are other allegations. One of the sources that I used in my other videos that I use for leads is the now-deleted Twitter account Zenny Jardine, or Jardin, however you pronounce it, who collected enormous amounts of information related to Epstein's flight logs and the Edge Club, and he made numerous allegations. And I had thought it was the rare female autist in action reporting her research on a random Twitter account. I only just discovered that she was there. She was one of the girls at the Edge Club, and she's now making accusations against the likes of John Brockman, which I arrived at merely by deduction. According to Zenny Jardine, the dinner she attended was paid for by Jeffrey Epstein and Yuri Milner, a Russian billionaire. When the U.S. Treasury placed sanctions on him, he became an Israeli and sanctions were dropped. A World Economic Forum member and a G8 summit speaker, Yuri Milner is another devotee on the quest for the Holy Grail. He and Amazon's Jeff Bezos have funded Altos Labs, which claims to have reprogrammed the biological clock of animals. Bezos is also an investor in Unity Biotechnology, another anti-aging company. Then there's Calico Labs, Google founder Larry Page's de-aging company, who has partnered with Ancestry DNA and others, because 23andMe, that's just not enough. Like the portrait of Dorian Gray, though, Google keeps their de-aging research deeply secret, saying they can't even speak about the fundamentals of their research. Felipe Sierra, director of the Division of Aging Biology at the NIH National Institute on Aging, asked Calico scientists to present at NIH, quote, "They come to the meeting, but they don't talk about what they are doing. They wouldn't even talk about the general direction of their research." So as I cycle through pictures taken from the Edge Club meetings, just watch for names and faces that you've seen before. Pictured alongside alleged Epstein fixer Sarah Kellen is another alleged victim of Jeffrey Epstein's, a girl claimed to be Cindy Lopez. Cindy Lopez appears on multiple Epstein flight logs, including those involving Bill Clinton. Supposedly, she was on more than 30 of the flights and worked for the modeling agency of Jean-Luc Brunel, who Jeffrey Epstein financed. And if you don't know, he was accused of decades of sexual abuse against minors, and he also didn't kill himself in jail, also by hanging. And During my research, I think I've uncovered a lead into this Cindy Lopez's identity, their age, and their origin, but that'll have to be the content of the next video if I don't Epstein myself between now and then. But that is still not all. The girl in the grips of John Brockman here is yet another alleged Epstein victim by the name of Banu, who is listed many, many times on the flight logs. Her age here is given at between 12 and 14, but once again, this allegedly trafficked girl has no digital footprint to verify either way. In this image of Banu and John Brockman is Kelly Bovino. Virginia Guffrey accuses Bovino of being another Ghislaine. It is a coincidence worth mentioning, then, that Banu and Olga of Greece both attended the Edge Club the same year as Marvin Minsky, another one of Virginia Guffrey's accused victimizers. The internet seems devoid of further information on these girls. They have no digital footprint, so it's impossible to verify their age or who they are. Not only them, but also this girl, who was filmed outside of Epstein's mansion.
When I saw him either in the United States, when I saw him in the United States, or when I was staying in his houses in the United States, there was no indication, absolutely no indication.
So you would have made that connection because you stayed with him, you were a visitor, a guest on many occasions at his homes, and nothing struck you as suspicious?
No, nothing.
During that whole time?
Nothing.
They saw many young girls coming and going at the time. There is video footage of Epstein accompanied by young girls. And you were there staying in his house, catching up with friends.
If they were, then I wasn't a party to any of that. I never saw them.
What would an Epstein expose be without Prince Andrew? While I don't think Bill Gates' relationship to Epstein had anything to do with young girls, Andrew is a different case. The evidence and motives are both there. But I don't think that's the end of the story. By the way, did you notice the second girl? Face look familiar? Sarah Kellen? Are you aware, people who haven't seen my videos, of Prince Andrew's meetings with the Canadian Epstein, Peter Nygaard?
I've been using all kinds of them. I've been I've been going to Russia to get the stem cells from there because they've been a leader in the world on, and they happen to be dealing with a very high level embryonic type of stem cell. You know, I've been using umbilical cord, you know, which is a big issue for China. I've been using, you know, placenta stem cells, which is very, very powerful. I've been using the stem cell cord blood, you know, to do for my brain and my own, you know, taking out of my own, you know, and then taking it, you know, out. And then
a rather rich and famous fashion designer from Canada, Nygaard was arrested on charges of sex trafficking girls to his Caribbean island.
Nygaard owns homes all over the world, including this huge estate in the Bahamas, where he's entertained Britain's Prince Andrew. Yes, that's the same British royal linked to the Jeffrey Epstein scandal. Like Epstein, Nygaard has a luxurious compound in the sun-kissed Caribbean.
But now there are allegations that Nygaard was using this exotic paradise as a sex trafficking ring.
When you saw these latest allegations, were you surprised or not?
No, not the least bit surprised.
Victoria Sarnay says she was Nygaard's personal assistant for a time in the early 90s.
The girls would come down in the morning looking absolutely dreadful, and saying, you know, can you get us out of here? Can you get us out of here?
Really?
And we'd say, no, we can't, because we didn't bring you in, so you've got to go ask him for your plane ride back.
And like the other Epstein, Peter Nygaard also had a Caribbean-based DNA startup.
Prime Minister Christie has shown tremendous courage and political savvy, you know, to guide this through the legislature.
But I want you to know that stem cell legislation will be passed by us today. God bless Peter Nygaard.
Nygaard began de-aging himself by impregnating eggs via in vitro fertilization, removing the original fetus DNA, implanting his own cloned cells, then implanting the cloned fertilized ovum into female surrogates, and then later harvesting the developed fetus to create a custom cell line.
From the woman's egg, we took out her DNA, put my old 70-year-old DNA in its place, grew it in vitro, developed embryonic stem cells, 8-0. This is huge.
The way in which these stem cell lines were derived is from embryos that are created in the process of in vitro fertilization.
When he needed a lab to do this kind of research on baby parts, where did he settle?
We traveled everywhere in the world now for the last 2 years, just looking.
In Shenzhen, Peter forges a partnership with BGI, the world leader in genome sequencing.
Well, there is something else notable about this facility, and that would be the BGI Genomics George Church Institute of Regenesis. George Church, the father of genetics, the one name to take away from this story. Yeah, he's in this crazy Chinese de-aging lab. Go figure. I'm just a crazy conspiracy theorist when I point out that Bill Gates has personally visited the lab. If I wasn't showing 10 articles and 3 pictures and a fucking video as proof of every claim I make, I'd think I was crazy too. The absolute silence from everyone about this makes me question my sanity, even standing here from atop this pile of evidence and looking out at the view. If I told someone that Jeffrey Epstein had a stockpile of nuclear missiles mounted on ICBMs aimed at every major city, I feel like they would just shrug and say, yep. Like they do, both online and reality. And yet, he had something far more dangerous. The gene drive. Unlike a bomb, the gene drive is invisible and silent. No nuclear bomb, not even a significant nuclear war, could destroy a major genus or family of species, and especially not all life on Earth. But the technology that was created in Epstein's lab could. And now that technology is in the hands of Bill Gates being tested for full deployment. It is certainly worth questioning whether a depopulation advocate would ever use something like this on the human population, say by exploiting some sort of public health crisis. How could somebody do something so evil? By the good of their own conscience. Somebody who believed that overpopulation would cause immense poverty and disease and human suffering, that it is better to just not exist than to suffer. We see this mentality among ethical veganism, who would rather just see billions of lives unlived, rather than barter on concerns like living conditions. It's the ethos of the abortionist, who believes that paying your cell phone bill is indeed more important than economically supporting your child. You need to get rid of it and give that money to Apple. You've got a Netflix subscription to keep up, right?
When I was growing up, my parents were always involved in various volunteer things. My dad was head of Planned Parenthood. And it was very controversial to be involved with that.
But still, you would be irrevocably changing the world. You'd be committing mass genocide. I mean, a normal person might object to something like that. Well, maybe not if you preserved the genome. For example, say in the world's largest DNA repository, or maybe several such repositories.
You know, thank God the digital world is sort of giving us infinite storage and computation, because geneticists are one of the few people who can fill up those disks.
And we're doing it.
So thank you for all of your data that will allow these cloud computing facilities to grow with no end in sight.
They have a great future.
Now, you have a backup for all the damage you caused. You've preserved the building blocks of each individual for posterity in a way that even the ancient Egyptians' pharaohs never realized. You've saved people from immense suffering of a Malthusian catastrophe, and while many people will be unable to enjoy a traditional family, nobody really wants those anymore anyway. And really, if they truly, truly desire it, you can sell them back their own fertility at a dear price. You will peacefully sunset the declining population in comfort while granting them a sort of pseudo-immortality as gene sequences stored on silicone chips.
And we're doing it.
This is huge.
The way in which these stem cell lines were derived is from embryos that are created in the process of in vitro fertilization.
This is the biggest thing that's ever happened in the history of the world. This is way bigger than electronics, you know, the electronic boom, you know, the computerization. This business is 10 times the size of that, you know, and there's nothing bigger than in this world has ever seen.
And what better motivation to silence a man forever than to power over life and death? To prevent global scrutiny on a project like this, it would be far preferable to simply cut a loose end and let the story of the girls trail off into the public rather than to have that thread pulled and the entire web unfurl. El Chapo Guzman's lawyer's presence tells me that Epstein was leaned on. Do you remember when he was beaten in his cell not long before he didn't kill himself, and it wasn't by his cellmate? Since I don't know how to end this, I figure I'll shoehorn this in, and it just goes to demonstrate what I've been trying to convey in this video. From the article, "What was the real relationship between Jeffrey Epstein and Bill Gates? How a young neuroscientist became a connection between Microsoft co-founder and the pedophile financier," by Vicky Ward, August 3rd, 2021. Skipping the introduction, in Bill Gates' case, one conduit to him was a protege of Epstein's. Her name is Melanie S. Walker. Walker is a neuroscientist and neurosurgeon who became a top advisor to Gates at his foundation after that and became a senior advisor at the World Bank. The Gates Foundation placed her at the International Financial Institution in a somewhat common arrangement called a secondment. What this means is that the foundation paid her salary even though she was working for the World Bank. If you follow me, you'll see that I have exposed that sort of scheme before, where billionaires use money to get people put into mayor's offices as aides and stuff like that. It really shows what we're up against when Bill Gates can just pay people to work at the World Bank for them. World Bank can't afford his own employees.
The kind of diversity that they're bringing into the room isn't about policies, it's about who they are. And if a new member of a state legislature suddenly spending 3 weeks with a lesbian or a trans woman or a trans man, the ripple effects are astonishing.
Good morning. Good morning. I see y'all are the ones that aren't hungover from last night. Yay. Or else you're the early risers. Good morning. I'm glad to see so many of you here. It's not quite 9 o'clock. We're pretty close.
She found herself in such echelons in a rather intriguing way. Walker came from a working-class family in Texas. As she reached adulthood, she was beautiful and bright. Having finished her undergraduate studies at the University of Texas, she was on a sightseeing trip to New York in 1992. She was having tea in the mailroom at the Plaza Hotel when Jeffrey Epstein approached because, a source says with knowledge, he thought she was attractive. With him was Donald Trump, who was busy shaking hands with people in the room. Trump was then the Plaza's owner. Trump also introduced himself to Walker. Epstein then became a mentor to Walker. Walker told the Times that Epstein offered her a modeling opportunity. But the person familiar says Epstein told her not to go into modeling, and he encouraged her to finish medical school, which she did. From 1992 to 2000, the time period that she went to medical school in Texas, records show that she listed an address in a New York apartment building that Epstein owned. This was a place she could use for occasional meetings in New York, according to that person familiar with her. But this person says she didn't live there. According to a source with knowledge, in 1998, while she was pursuing a postdoctoral study at Caltech, Epstein hired her as his science advisor. She would later tell people who then spoke to me that she felt a deep gratitude toward Epstein, both for his advice and for the job. A source who was friendly with Epstein then recalls her role as providing Epstein with introductions to interesting faculty members at Caltech and elsewhere, people whose work he might be interested in funding. This person recalls meeting her at a dinner at Epstein's house in New York. Her relationship with Epstein seemed only professional to this observer. Around the same time, she and Prince Andrew became close friends, but not through Epstein, at least according to a source with knowledge.
All of this goes back to your friendship with Jeffrey Epstein. Mm. How did you first become friends? How did you meet?
Well, I met through his girlfriend back in 1999, and I'd known her since she was at university in the UK.
The story goes, according to that source, that Walker received a spare ticket to a Broadway show from a different friend and sat next to Prince Andrew. As you do, just casually, accidentally sit next to Prince Andrew after you've been working for Epstein, and it's just coincidence. That sounds like a very questionable alibi as to why you were photographed in a public place with Prince Andrew. What that sounds like to me. In the early 2000s, as she found herself in Seattle and for the first time in the orbit of Bill Gates, I meet these people all the time, you know, just walking around, bang, Bill Gates, bang, I walk right into a prince. It's fucking everywhere, these people. In the orbit of Bill Gates, this was after she moved in with an executive at Microsoft. His name is Steven Sinofsky. According to an eyewitness, Sinofsky brought Walker to Microsoft events, and at a company barbecue, she met the Microsoft founder. In 2006, she was hired by the Gates Foundation, partially so she would stay in Seattle, along with Sinofsky, says a person familiar. A separate source says that during this time, Walker talked highly about Epstein. It's interesting how Bill Gates and the World Bank have all this use for a neurosurgeon with 8 years of medical experience, isn't it? Meanwhile, two other people close to Gates and to Walker, the physician Boris Nikolic and the scientist Nathan Myhrvold, also had met Epstein and also talked up Epstein to Gates, says this source. At this time, some of the people in the Gates Foundation had gotten the impression from Epstein that he was a billionaire and therefore a potential contributor to the Giving Pledge, and that his time in prison in 2009 was mostly undeserved. Epstein had told them that he had simply caught a bad rap for an experience with women who had lied about their age. Sources say Nikolic multiple accidents. That's women plural, not just one. I'm sure they bought it. He must have had a real good story. Really, really good story, that Epstein. Totally believable. Sources say Nikolic was impressed with Epstein's ideas for fundraising, as was Gates, who met Epstein in early 2011 at a dinner, according to the New York Times. I have questions about that timeline, but this video is getting long enough already. Gates and Epstein worked together on a global health fund. Everything went well until, according to the New York Times description of a pitch document, Epstein asked a cut of any donations that he had helped facilitate from high net worth individuals. Nikolic would subsequently run into Epstein a few times a year, either at the Davos World Economic Forum, which Epstein wouldn't attend but rented a chalet nearby, or at TED conferences, where he also wouldn't enter, but where Epstein regardless set up camp, or at Harvard, where Nikolic worked. The encounters, according to the source, were brief and pleasant. Nothing materialized from his outreach to Gates. Sources say Epstein made a final fuck you to Gates 2 days before he died. At this moment, he appointed Nikolic as a substitute executor of his will. Nikolic said he had no meaningful contact with Epstein for years, so the move could have been designed to shine light on the Gates-Epstein relationship, with the full knowledge that it would be extraordinarily damaging to Gates' reputation. I reached out to Niklik, who told me in an email exchange that he had fainted at his mother's wake when he heard of his appointment, and that it was absolutely a retaliatory move. I hope this video has proven that there was much more to the Epstein story than the simple trafficking of girls. While so many elites are smeared by their very presence at Epstein-funded conferences or being escorted on his plane, it's very telling that none of those elites being smeared have come out to reveal the true nature of their relationship. It's almost as if they were hiding something they find even more important. Which leads to the final portion of this video. Rank speculation on who killed Epstein if Epstein didn't kill himself. Disclaimer, this is speculation, not accusation. This video already mentioned Bill Gates' interest in silencing Epstein, which was the depopulation research undertaken at Epstein's lab. The strongest evidence is the naming of the Gates Foundation science advisor in Epstein's will, and their shared interest in George Church, which doesn't need rehashing. The answer as to who killed Epstein might be as simple as the witness to Epstein's will, the one that he signed 2 days before he didn't kill himself. That would be El Chapo Guzman's lawyer. Guzman was a fellow inmate, and the fact that his lawyer paid a visit to Epstein to sign a will and transfer out $500 million to an untraceable account, well, that speaks volumes. If you're familiar with the arrest of El Chapo Guzman's son, the motive for the negligence of the guards explains itself. Guzman wouldn't have the guards killed, he'd have their families killed, and then them. While Gates has the contacts and all the means required to make a man disappear from a supermax prison, even he would not have access to the caliber of men that Prince Andrew could field, such as straight-up SAS mercenaries. Andrew's operatives would have access to the type of MI5 spy gear that could make a couple of guards take a nap, forget to go on their patrols, and lose track of time. Between the two of them, the networks that they have, they could get investigations dropped. And so those are my chief suspects.
Epstein was found dead.
Yep.
In prison.
Yes.
In August of this year.
Yep.
What was your response on hearing that he'd died?
Shock.
Some people think that he didn't take his own life.
Well, there again, I'm not one to be able to answer that question.
Well, that's pretty much everything. This video has been hundreds and hundreds of hours in the making, along with the prior research and video editing. There are a lot more people traveling down this track these days than there was when I first researched it. Hopefully this kind of information gets out there before it's too late. And on that note, I'll leave you with the words of the Gene Drive creator, Kevin Esvelt.
The strong version of the precautionary principle says don't do anything until you can understand all of the consequences. And that's fine as long as you get to stay where you are if you do nothing. But that's not the world we live in. It might seem that way to some people, but that's not the world we live in. Civilization is not sustainable. We need continued invention. We need new technologies, because otherwise we're eroding our natural resource base and we have to invent our way out of it. There's no other choice. We've passed the point of no return. There's too many people. We need to be more efficient. We need new technologies, and they have to be ever more powerful. But that's a double-edged sword. How do you ensure that we use them wisely? How do you ensure that we don't accidentally open a technological box that destroys us all? They're out there. There are some in biology. I'm not going to talk about it further, but they're out there. There are also some countermeasures that people are working on that will hopefully ensure that those boxes stay closed and eliminate those risks. But how many more are out there that we haven't seen? How many are out there in other fields? I mean, people are very aware of this in AI as a potential risk. People are very aware of this when it comes to nuclear weapons. How many other things are out there that we just, that no one has thought of? But that really wasn't enough, right? Because people are going to want to use this. And as long as people want to use this, eventually someone will. That is to say, if it is possible for a small group of scientists to build something that could take a decent crack out of malaria, someone's going to want to be a hero and release it without consulting everyone else.